Hi, I'm Andrey, and I'm an engineer on Google News team. I'm here to talk about some things we learned about building performant web UI while being the Google News phone and tablet mobile web apps. I'll describe how we worked around the shortcomings of mobile devices and took advantage of modern browser features and ultimately delivered engaging and fast news experience. Mobile devices are rapidly becoming the dominant platform to access online content and services. Rapid growth of mobile devices present a great opportunity, but also come with their own set of technical and product challenges. Technically, mobile devices generally suffer from slow and unreliable networks, limited memory, relatively weak CPU and GPU, and of course, limited screen size. At the same time, most of mobile devices have modern OSs and have browsers which are HTML5 compliant, with features like local storage and touch events. This opens new ways to create engaging web apps. One of the most prominent challenges on phones is slow network connections. This means that phone apps should limit data consumption to as little as possible on a connection. Now, this may prompt developers to retrieve as little data as possible on one data connection and make frequent data calls. This approach could backfire, as opening a connection is quite expensive and time-consuming. So a balance needs to be maintained between data transfer on one connection and opening multiple connections. On Google News, we balance this by getting all the textual data of the phone web app in one call to the server. Images are fetched later on, as they are not critical to the news reading experience, as are various scripts and resources which are not immediately needed. Another workaround to slow connections is to optimize data access around product usage patterns. In Google News, we try to predict what the user would do next and prefetch that data. This means we can show content to your users as quickly as possible. For example, when a user swipes to a section, it's a good indication that user could swipe to next section of our app as well. In that case, we prefetch the next few sections while the user is active on the current section. Another technique that we use is to fetch partial content of a page beforehand. For example, we retrieve the first article of all news stories while fetching a section page data. When the user navigates to a story page, we display the first article immediately while fetching other articles on the news story. We also show a silhouette instead of an empty white space while fetching the rest of the story page. This gives users some content to interact with immediately and indicates to the user that more content is being retrieved. Static resources such as JavaScript, CSS, and sprites can be stored in local storage. Thus, the application will avoid making HTTP head calls to verify that the cached browser version of the file is good to use. This saves a few round trips to the server. So these are some of the transport layer considerations. But what about mobile browser level optimizations? Layout and rendering done by browser internals in the CPU and GPU have many more deficiencies compared to typical desktop or laptop machines today. You must be careful when manipulating and accessing properties of DOM elements, as it may result in full or partial screen re-layout and redraws. Use Chrome DevTools Timeline View to see what browser spends time doing frame by frame. And you can turn on various experimental settings that show internal drawing and invalidate rectangles of the browser. When moving HTML elements on the screen, especially in response to user gestures, use HTML5 3D transforms. This will offload render processing to the GPU, resulting in a much smoother experience. GPU memory is quite limited, so try to move only the elements which are visible and hide the invisible sides of elements. For elements that are about to appear on the screen, like when a pane is about to be swiped onto a screen, it's very helpful to bring them into the DOM structure well ahead of time and make them renderable, meaning you need to set CSS display property to something other than none. Browsers are typically capable of performing layout and paint of such off-screen elements on a separate thread, often prioritizing among different elements based on distance to visible viewport. If you absolutely need to animate something with JavaScript, use the Request Animation Frame API callbacks to synchronize DOM changes with the vSync. Everything we've talked about so far is also good practice when developing other non-mobile web applications. But one key feature that singles out mobile applications is that they're controlled through gestures. Natively, browsers support vertical swipes to do vertical scroll of the main body element, but if you want your application to respond to a horizontal swipe or other gestures like pinch, you will need to process raw touch events in JavaScript and animate appropriate parts of the UI. To do so, the touch start event should be processed and consecutive touch move and ultimate touch end events should also be processed in this JavaScript. And this is where it gets tricky. For UI to appear smooth, all transitions should run at about 60 frames per second, which leaves about 16 milliseconds per frame. The main thread that's responsible for reporting and executing application-specific touch event handlers must complete script execution in those and browser pending within those 16 milliseconds. What this means is that code in touch start and especially touch move handlers should complete in no more than a few milliseconds. For comparison, full screen layout repaint might take 20 to 30 milliseconds, resulting in several skipped frames. The thing that allows to repaints to be quick is CSS3D transforms, which move elements on screen as raster images rather than trying to repaint DOM structure. Once you've optimized touch event handlers, you can do browser-level optimizations to streamline browser event processing and reduce overhead associated with event DOM propagation. One way to achieve this is to listen to all touch events on a single top-level DOM element in capture mode. This will result in no DOM event propagation, chopping valuable milliseconds from touch event processing on the main thread. In our phone web app, we wrote a small framework that did just that. It processed raw touch events at the top-level element, converted these touch events to gestures, such as drag left, drag right, up and down, and routed these gestures to an appropriate subcomponent of the application based on subcomponent reported screen rectangles for which it should be notified of gestures. The last topic of this talk is phone versus tablet UI. A common debate is how different phone and tablet UIs should be. One school of thought is to have responsive websites where a site is automatically adjusted to the available screen size and capabilities. In our experience, this approach doesn't work very well. First, a UI that adjusts dynamically results in complicated code and limits optimization choices. But more importantly, what we have found is that phone and tablet consumption models are very different. Phone consumption happens more frequently in a day, but a session lasts only a few minutes. This is what we call the snacking mode of news consumption. This means it is much better to have an information-dense and more summarized view of news. Whereas tablet usage is very much limited to morning and evening hours, with the user interacting for an extended period of time. So it made much more sense to provide in-depth reading choices on tablets. We hope this talk will help you avoid some common pitfalls of web development on mobile platforms, and will inspire you to code slick and fun web applications for many users to enjoy. Thank you, and see you at news.google.com.